The music of Unsuk Chin seeks to communicate with listeners on a multitude of levels. Her music is labyrinthine, full of contrast, and neither tonal nor atonal, a curious blend of ritual and nonsense. This lecture recital focuses on Chin's two major percussion works, Allegro Mod on Troppo for solo percussion and tape, and Double Concerto for percussion, prepared piano, and ensemble. The purpose of this study is to produce a performer's guide to these compositions designed to assist percussionists in preparation and interpretation of the two pieces. Throughout this analysis, I will specifically address problems and practical solutions regarding instrumentation, technical approaches and practice suggestions for the many virtuosic passages within the pieces, considerations of balance and blend, and finally, how an understanding of Chin's extra musical influences might inform one's interpretation of the theatrical elements specific to Allegro Mod on Troppo. From the cacophonous barrage of garbage percussion hurled about in the opera Alice in Wonderland, to the contrapuntal interplay of episode between bottles and cans, from Gugelon, strings from a street theater, percussion plays a significant role in the music of Unsuk Chin. Born in Seoul, South Korea in 1961, Chin's composition studies at Seoul National University led to her receiving a scholarship to study with avant-garde composer George Ligeti in Berlin from 1985 to 1988. Under Ligeti's demanding tutelage, Chin developed her unique voice as a composer, with a fondness for the sounds of plucked or struck strings, slowly drifting glissandi, and creative blends of timbre. Chin considers her working experience with electronic music and her preoccupation with Balinese gamelan as influential to her work. Her two works for percussion exemplify several key compositional characteristics central to her musical language. Although there is a dearth of research to be found on Unsuk Chin, several sources, including interviews, essays, and over a dozen dissertations, provide insight into the composer's compositional process and aesthetic. Chin's essay, Courage, is a reflection of her musical journey and thoughts on music history, including her interest in the music of John Cage and Harry Partch, both of whom had great influence on her use of percussion. From a compositional standpoint, three unifying concepts emerge that are central to the essence of Chin's musical personality: dream logic, virtuosity, and Chin's desire to communicate to a universal audience through her music. In an often cited description of her music, Chin addresses the importance of dreams. My music is a reflection of my dreams. I try to render into music the visions of immense light and of incredible magnificence of colors that I see in all my dreams, forming a fluid sound sculpture. Chin expands upon this concept further, addressing the influence of dream logic. According to Chin, the visions of my dreams represent a far more existential level of experience than anything I have known in my everyday life. Dreams are, for me, an encounter with another world in which utterly different physical laws prevail. Sometimes a dream is so complex that as soon as you wake up, only vaguely memory of it remains. When you try to describe such a complex dream state in words, the result is inevitably what we call nonsense. Because our logic is subject to a very different type of logic, a kind of dream logic. While Chin carefully maintains that her music is abstract and not literally about her dreams, the influence of dream logic is key in perceiving the essence of her compositions. Another equally definitive characteristic of Chin's artistic output is the virtuosic demands placed on the performers. While virtuosity is not exclusive to her concerto output, the solo parts in these concertos showcase the most extreme examples of these demands. As Chin describes, "My ideas spring from the virtuosity of each musician. I want them to stand on stage and push themselves further in their mental and musical possibilities. All of my concertos are technically really difficult. Everybody has to fight to survive." It should be noted, however, that the difficulty is not merely an empty or meretricious display of flashy technique for its own sake, but a vehicle or means to creating a complex, unified sound world. For Chin, her attraction to virtuosity is analogous to the compositional process, pushing the limits, unsure of the outcome, and somehow succeeding. Despite the virtuosic demands and dreamlike textures encompassing her works, Chin intends her music to have broad appeal. This is a break from the trend of musical elitism that composers of complex music often hold over their listeners. According to Chin, "I never write pieces for my composer colleagues. I write pieces for members. There are the normal classical music lovers, there are the professional new music lovers, and there are the people who have never had anything to do with music. For me, a good piece of music is one in which people from all these different types of groups maybe don't understand everything, but can at least get something out of it. It is very important to me that my music speaks to all." While fortunately, music has the capability to go beyond surface-level beauty, embracing the listener's curiosity rather than the kind of elitism present in the attitudes of some composers with a similar musical language, is a far more effective way to connect with the music. Understanding the centrality of these compositional characteristics at the root of Chin's music sheds light not only on the essence of her two percussion works, but on the uniqueness of these pieces within the solo percussion and the percussion concerto genres. In double concerto, as with each of her six concertos to date, Chin seeks to push the technical abilities of the soloists to the extreme, while exploring the relationship between soloist and orchestra from many different perspectives. However, in contrast to a traditional double concerto of the Baroque, classical, or romantic eras, where the two soloists are typically placed in a kind of dialogue between one another and the orchestra, Chin is more concerned with the melding the timbres of the percussion and piano soloists along with the orchestra into what she calls a hyper instrument. Additionally, rather than any kind of extended solo passages or cadenzas typical of the concerto genre, the soloists are interlocked in relentless, constantly evolving ostinato patterns, while the virtuosic demands extend into the orchestra, resembling in some ways a kind of contemporary concerto for orchestra. Throughout the work, the symbiotic relationship of the soloists functions as the lifeblood of the piece. According to Chin, the emphasis of percussion and percussive timbres creates a sound world whose landmarks lie both in Western and non-European music. Chin also confirms that Balinese gamelan music is a principal influence on the piece's composite timbres and rhythmic structure. Understanding this relationship between the soloists is crucial to the percussionist's process in preparing the piece, particularly in regards to balance selection, and overall rehearsal strategies with the pianist. As a basic overview of instrumentation for the percussion soloist, it is best to view the layout of instruments as four different stations which must be arranged in a way that allows the percussionist to swiftly navigate from station to station, as well as to maintain clear views of the pianist and conductor at all times. These four stations consist of 1, vibraphone with 6 Herdenglocken, which are tuned cowbells placed directly in front of the vibraphone, 3 suspended tubular bells to either side of the player, a Japanese temple bell, and a pair of small crash cymbals. Station 2, marimba, only a 4-octave is required, and 2 octaves of chincheros positioned directly in front of the marimba. Station 3 is xylophone, while Station 4 contains a multiple drum setup consisting of tenor drum, 3 tom-toms, and 3 timpani. For my performance of double concerto, I chose to have the instruments in 2 rows facing in towards the orchestra, with stations 1 and 2 in the front row, and stations 3 and 4 in the back row. There are several issues regarding specific instrumentation that the percussionist must address, the most pressing of which is the ambiguity of the differences between the 6 Herdenglocken from station 1, each tuned to a specific pitch, and the 2 octaves of chincheros from station 2, also pitched. Traditionally, when composers such as Mahler, Stockhausen, and Messiaen call for tuned cowbells, they are typically referring to a resonant brass instrument called Almglocken, Alm meaning alpine pasture. The term chinchero traditionally describes the Latin American cowbell, which is much less resonant than Almglocken. However, Messiaen calls for chromatic sets of chincheros, which percussionist Mike Rosen confirms are Almglocken. At the end of the day, the performer must choose instruments that are appropriate for the musical context. For the 6 cowbells, I use Almglocken with moon gel applied to eliminate some of the ringing. For the chromatic set of chincheros, my first choice would also be Almglocken. However, purchasing or renting 2 octaves of these instruments can be extremely expensive, not to mention the required mounting system to make them playable from the marimba. For my performance, I used a digital sound library from Vienna Instruments, run through Apple's Logic Pro 10 to a MIDI keyboard, the Pearl Mallet Station. This solution, though not ideal, allows me to perform the chinchero music in a practical and affordable way. Similar to how Broadway percussionists might exchange smaller instruments for those too large to fit in the performance space. While this is a convenient and completely viable replacement, one unfortunate sacrifice is dynamic contrast that is naturally more musically fulfilling with the actual acoustic instrument. However, as technology improves over time, these methods of substitution become increasingly practical and acceptable. For the cowbells at station 1, I use an accessory bar mounted on a cymbal stand, with the cowbells evenly spaced to avoid touching. I found it incredibly useful to establish the exact location of the cowbells in relation to the vibraphone as early as possible in the process of learning the piece. While not as crucial as the cowbell dilemma, Chen calls for pitches in the vibraphone that can only be achieved on an extended range version of the instrument. These notes only occur in one section of the piece and can easily be transposed down an octave if such an instrument is not available to the performer. A final concern regarding instrumentation comes from the section percussionist part rather than the soloist. Chin calls for a lithophone, which is essentially a chromatic set of tuned rocks. While this rare instrument could be built, rented, or created by finding rocks which are appropriately resonant and pitched, Chin has offered that it is acceptable to substitute this instrument with a synthetic non-wood xylophone. So you can get a sense of the following excerpts of the double concerto in context, and as the nature of the lecture recital does not allow for a full performance of the piece, the following examples will be supplemented by selections from my performance of double concerto from October 2019, featuring piano soloist Jacob Dyke and the CCM Chamber Orchestra under the direction of Dr. Kevin Holtzman. The beginning of the work presents some of the most challenging music of the entire piece. The opening ostinato pattern is exclusively played by the soloists with a constant stream of quintuplets on vibraphone and cowbells marked pianissimo, and a tempo marking ranging between 104 and 112 beats per minute. The pattern is interrupted by occasional glissandi on the vibraphone, which are labeled with pedal markings. Chin calls for medium hard mallets to achieve a slightly metallic tone. She notes that the percussion should blend completely with the piano timbre. Mallet choice is crucial to ensure that the vibraphone and cowbells sound as homogeneous as possible, while being able to produce an appropriate sound for the glissandi. Other than a few isolated moments, Chin does not dictate pedaling for the vibes here. However, I find it appropriate to apply touches of pedaling here and there to match the length of the duration of the cowbell sounds, while also achieving a more characteristic sound on the vibraphone. Here's the opening of the piece, rehearsal letter A to B.
Thank you.
the sort of metallic, distorted sounds in the piano there. Following the conclusion of the first major section of the piece, there is a transition moment featuring isolated single attacks of tubular bells, timpani, and the only instance of the small cymbals and the Japanese temple bell in the entire work. This transition leads into the next major section, played at station 2. The transitional material sounds like this. Station 2, there are several short instances of marimba alone, including two moments where the marimba rises softly out of the orchestral chambers and then vanishes back into nothing. Chin calls for very soft mallets here and hard mallets for the rest of the marimba material. You will also hear several isolated gestures from the chincheros, as well as moments of simultaneous playing with the right hand above on the chincheros and the left hand filling in the gaps on bass notes in the marimba voice. Chin separates each instrument into a grand staff, which is practical and easy to read due to each hand playing a different instrument. However, towards the end of this section, a sequence for chincheros alone, she keeps the two staves, resulting in an incredibly difficult passage to read. Chin notates the music this way to designate left hand in the bottom staff, right hand in the top staff. But this could have easily been done using a single staff, as the notes all occur within two octaves of one another. For these purposes, I have found it helpful to renotate the part in a single staff, resulting in a much more manageable reading experience. Here's a brief example of this music in context. becoming gradually more complex and more involved as the passage unfolds. Xylophone, piano, and other instruments of the orchestra interact playfully with one another. In this section, Chin uses two staves for the xylophone, both in treble clef, with the top staff containing the most activity and nearly always at piano, while the bottom staff is more sparse, featuring notes of various articulations and dynamics. While it could be helpful to renotate this into a single staff, as with the notation of the chincheros, I find that the separation into the two staves lends itself well to interpreting the character of this section of the music, while also presenting possible stickings that are unique to the layout of the parts. For example, I play much of the material on the top staff with one hand, connecting with the bottom staff pitches with the other for a more consistent sound on the repeating notes. While it is not possible nor practical to maintain this approach for the entirety of the passage, utilizing this method of sticking selectively presents unique opportunities for phrasing, especially when the notes get further apart from one another. For this passage, I use light xylophone mallets and must be careful not to overbalance the other players as they layer in. I will now play several excerpts from this section of the piece, I to K. Thank you. for this section, the percussionist must be rhythmically strong, carefully bringing out the accents, as the part is interlocked with the pianist in a heavy percussive ostinato pattern. This section is briefly interrupted by a six-measure phrase where the soloist has to travel to xylophone extremely quickly and then back to the drums even more quickly. Depending on space and availability of instruments, it is possible to use a second xylophone for this moment of the piece. However, as long as station 3 and 4 are positioned next to each other, there is a clear path. This transition is achievable. For my performance of this piece, my professor suggested separating the two largest timpani in the setup so that I could go through the setup rather than around, saving valuable seconds. I will now perform letter K through L. Climactic sequences of the piece, the player returns to the vibraphone at station 1. Here, Chen calls for several instances of the vibraphone motor on and off, as well as a variety of mallet types for sparse, ringing notes before transitioning into a longer, much more active section. Throughout, the performer could find the use of 4 mallets beneficial for certain moments of the passage. I find that only 2 mallets are required, freeing up the percussionist to execute some of the more demanding aspects of this moment in the piece. The part is musically and technically very different from the opening passage of the work, using fast-moving double stops and one-handed repeated notes, and is more minimal in its integration of the cowbells. I will now perform this section of the piece. to this part with the rest of the players, focusing on the blending of timbres and the soloistic trade-offs between the two, piano and percussion. Notice the distorted nature of the paired piano as we trade off these gestures. Though not every section of the piece has been addressed at length, it is my intention that the material focused on throughout this lecture recital addresses all primary concerns that the solo percussionist will encounter in double concerto. In an attempt to demystify and encourage future performances of this great work, originally conceived as a piece of musique concrète, Unsuk Chin produced Allegro Monon Troppo in the electronic studio of the Technical University of Berlin during the winter of 1993 and 1994. The original materials of the electronic version consist of sounds of silk paper, clocks, drops of water, and various percussion instruments, which Chin chooses to create the smoothest possible transitions between the various timbres of the piece. In 1998, Chin revised the work by adding a live percussion part, transforming Allegro Monon Troppo into an electroacoustic percussion solo with tape. Musically, the addition of the percussion instruments, Chin is again seeking, in her own words, to blur the differences, the boundaries between the natural and the artificial, by integrating the electronic and acoustic elements into a composite hyper instrument. In addition to to a series of drums, tam-tams, and gongs, Chin calls for over a dozen non-traditional found sound instruments, many of which occur only once in the piece. With this in mind, the percussionist must be extremely familiar with the electronic music, taking care to select appropriate sounds to be merged with the electronic manipulations of silk paper, clocks, and drops of water. Chin includes a click track for the performer, which greatly assists a successful performance of the work. So the emphasis on the percussionist's intimate knowledge of the electronic music is concerned primarily with timbre and balance, rather than tempo. Much of the work, with the exception of the sections featuring tam-tams and drums, is considerably more effective visually if performed from memory, though it is not mandatory. While the addition of percussion enhances the sound world of the piece, it also elevates the work into a kind of percussion theater that Chin refers to as a musical ceremony. Percussionist Ayun Huang defines percussion theater as live percussion music in which the theatrical interpretation plays a critical role in a successful performance of the piece, such as in works by composers like Kagel, Apergis, and DMA. Any performance of percussion instruments highlights the unique relationship of the visual and auditory aspect of the music. The visceral characteristics of the physical actions and gestures of the performer should help communicate the music that is being performed, while revealing the inherent visual nature of percussion performance. According to Huang, when the visual aspect of a performance is pivotal to comprehending the work, the piece can more clearly be understood as percussion theater. As Chin explains in recently upgraded program notes, one can look upon the live version of Allegro Monon Troppo as performance art in which the musical material of the tape is brought to life and made concrete by the stage actions of the percussionist. The player becomes engaged in a surreal dialogue with the virtual percussionist. These guidelines are further supplemented by the composer's aforementioned interest in dream logic, providing insight into possible interpretations of the work's theatrical narrative. Among Chin's extra musical influences are the works of Lewis Carroll and Franz Kafka, two authors known to be creatively and emotionally influenced by dreams, as well as surrealist filmmaker Louis Buñuel. Surrealist art often deals with the absurd. There are many aspects of Allegro Monon Troppo that are absurd. The use of a feather duster on tam-tams, gestures which seem to imply, at times, cleaning or cooking. Even the title of the work, which translates to fast, but not too much so, is slightly absurd when applied to this highly abstract music. I believe the key to the theatrical narrative of Allegro Monon Troppo lies somewhere between Chin's fascination with the nonsensical logic of dreams and her interest in blurring the boundaries between the natural and artificial, not only musically, but visually as well. The essence of the piece revolves around the surrealistic nature of familiar sounds and gestures juxtaposed in an out-of-place context. While the following quote is describing her thoughts on her opera, Alice in Wonderland, I feel that it is perfectly fits the aesthetic of Allegro Mon en Troppo. As the composer suggests, you've got a cute, clever surface, and madness lurks underneath. And there's the strict adherence to rules and logic that constantly tips over into the grotesque and the absurd. Whereas several available performances of the work highlight the absurd aspects of the piece, often in a tongue-in-cheek, over-the-top fashion, my own interpretation focuses on the familiarity of sound and gesture, the unaware dreamlike urgency where one is not sure what is real. For my own interpretation, I turn to influences of the visual arts, including certain aspects of films by directors like Leo Carrà and David Lynch, another artist who is directly influenced by Kafka's writings. It should be said that these inspirations are merely aesthetic and not direct. Without revealing much more about the specific approaches in my own interpretation, I will now perform Unsuk Chin's Allegro Mon en Troppo.
Mm-hmm.